veganism. Maybe you can talk about the past first.
Mm-hmm.
Like you grew up a meat eater.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe talk about how was it pre-vegan.
Mm-hmm.
Like what were the things you used to eat? Mm-hmm. What were the things that you used to enjoy eating?
Mm-hmm.
Like let's describe that life.
Okay. I this is not something I've forgotten. I used to like spam a lot.
Bring it up right now.
Spam. I used to eat a lot of spam. Bacon wasn't a thing. That one I never struggled with. You can't relate. But spam. Spam. Your typical baon.
Yeah.
Like your parents would send you off to school with chicken cordon bleu chicken nuggets, hot dogs. I particularly enjoyed a lot of cheeses and corned beef. So, and of course, all commercial chocolate, which all have milk powder.
Yeah.
So that was my regular
And what was
it?
I mean, like when you look back.
Yeah, that was my regular
diet. Like, is there nostalgia? Do you remember how it felt, like eating them before?
It's the same. I think it's the same experience that I have now, like the joy of feeling, the joy of being fed. Of feeling full, and of course at the time the experience translated as the joy of being nourished. So there is no I don't experience this nostalgia because I'm feeling the exact same things now.
Yeah.
But it's the same experience, the feeling fed, feeling nourished,
yeah,
feeling satisfied.
Yeah.
Satisfied is I think the key.
Yeah.
And what we've done, or I've done for myself, is I've managed to look at enough recipes to create dishes where I feel as satisfied as I've always been with on a regular diet.
Do you ever miss those kinds of food? Ever? Not recently, but maybe when you were becoming a vegetarian.
I was in transition for
transition to vegetarian, being a vegetarian.
No, for being vegan. I was from the time that I said, okay, I'm gonna give this thing a try, I allowed myself a year of being pescatarian. So this started January 2009. And I remember that while this was my New Year's resolution, we went to a New Year's Eve party, and the New Year's Eve party culminated in what's one of those places where you can eat, like Sinangag Express.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And halfway through my meal, I was like, wait, I have a New Year's resolution. So I had to push it aside, and I wanted to start with the momentum of like the whole new year.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, I'm not gonna eat this one. Things I struggled with was, I guess, the going back and forth with eggs. Eggs, I did. And it took me a long time to really make that transition to veganism on the level of taste, because I really enjoyed chocolates and sweets.
Yeah.
I was also already living on an island, so, you know, all these raw desserts wasn't accessible at the time. So, it took a while.
But, like, because, like, I mean, with me, mm-hmm, I'm not even fully vegetarian, fully mm-hmm vegan, but I try to be. I mm-hmm like how I feel.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, there's that I already kind of know when I'm going to start craving.
Right.
Like day 6, day 7 of going vegan every day.
Yeah.
Because it's like, it's comforter.
Yes.
You know, it's nostalgia. You know, but I feel it's really more just familiar comfort.
Right.
The taste.
Right.
It's not like I don't feel great when I eat it anymore.
Yes.
But do you feel like, why was it struggles like so long transitioning into becoming vegan?
You know, for us who have the good fortune and the good karma of being able to eat 3 times a day, who have been able to eat 3 times a day at the minimum from the time that we were born, there is a very, even if this is unconscious, and I realized this only later on, food has become a foundation for our mental and emotional, and arguably at the time, physical health. It was a foundation. And at least for me, I can relate to that concept of finding comfort in food, in the fact that from the time that I decided to give or to explore this world of vegetarianism and veganism, my whole life was also in a process of change. Shortly after that, I had graduated from university and had to start thinking about what I was going to do with the rest of my existence. And things happened so quickly from there to the soon enough, I found myself making or giving my best effort or putting all of my energy into moving into the island. And of course, that caused a lot of emotional stress created by expectations that my parents had for me, not knowing how to do anything for myself at the time. Everything on an economic level I relied on my parents for. So, you know, all of these things, and still trying to give or to do something good, and that says to stick to certain principles while in the midst of all of these conflicts. Long story short, I had only become a vegan. And then, of course, the relationships that you forge and lose along the way. It was, change was probably the most prominent theme in the last 8 years of my life. 10 years of my life. And I've only become vegan in the last 3 years of that period. And it's because when everything else I had no control over, food.
Yeah.
I had control over my food, and so I approached it looking for that sense of comfort, because everything else was not giving me that comfort.
Yeah. I guess because I feel like now in this day and age, a lot of people like are more open to being vegan. A lot more vegan options now, but I guess like me, I'm still in the process. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'll ever become completely vegan, but with my body, it reacts very differently when I eat meat.
Right.
You know, I do feel a lot lighter when I eat more plant-based, but it's still a struggle, you know. And I guess, I mean, I would want people to like be more, like just try it out,
because I
never thought I would see the difference in terms of like the physical experience of it, and even the clarity,
the mental.
Mm-hmm. But I think that's the thing. I mean, like, so I was asking you about, you know, your struggle, because it really is a journey, naman talaga.
It is.
Like, you can't, naman, there's no, people say that you can't force it.
Mm.
It's just, I mean, when you're ready, if you're ready, then maybe you'll be able to do that switch.
Yeah.
You're able to commit to it.
Yeah.
But, like, maybe you can talk about, like, you know, the cafe, you know, with the food that you serve, and, like, I guess, like, how you pick the dishes, and, you know, what's the purpose of having like a vegan cafe here in Siargao?
I do just want to reinforce what you said about the journey to veganism, or the veganism is not like an ending point. Veganism is again a spectrum. I guess it's starting to reveal itself, at least to me, as I mean, in the same way that, for example, no one can know the full, like, yoga, like the fact that you are a practitioner of yoga, does that mean it's the end already? Veganism doesn't have an end, it's something that you do every day.
Yeah.
So it is a journey, and it's just that we get caught up in labels, and I can say, hey, I'm a vegan, and does that mean that the difficulties have I no longer encounter difficulties? No, maybe it's just that the difficulties are a little bit different now.
Yeah.
Like, okay, what am I going to prepare this time? It's more of the question than, for example, before it's like, I need to take 10 breaths before I decide to not touch that thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's more like that now. It's just that it doesn't end. It is a constant act of mindfulness. It's a practice of mindfulness in that sense. And it's a journey from maybe, okay, so fine, if there's an end, you're vegan, but most people are angry vegans. So again, it's a continuing journey, like it's not over. And I think that it's very helpful, for example, vegans, to remember that so that they... Because I guess meeting a vegan is intimidating. When I used to meet vegans as a non-vegan, it was intimidating. I guess the labels automatically put up walls, whether or not that person was actually emanating any kind of vibes, you know.
Sure.
Okay, so I just wanted to say that. And then the cafe. Why so?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, what has brought me to the island and many people to the island, especially at the time when there was nothing here except nature, it's that. I guess it's reaffirming my my connection to nature by eating in this way. And through the restaurant, I would like to communicate to the persons that walk into the place and have a meal that I guess it's to reaffirm that and to express gratitude to nature by choosing to eat this way and to really showcase what is so great about it, that everything is literally already provided to us, that we don't have to take more than what was or is allotted to us. If maybe nature could speak, she would say something like, this is for you and this is for my other children, you know. And so that's really what we're just doing. We're taking what I would feel that if she was speaking, you know, only what she would be giving, something like that. For anyone who's up for the challenge, you will find so much satisfaction in creating with just vegetables. And really, everything is conditioned.
Yeah.
Even our tastes.
Yeah, agreed.
Even our tastes. It's not an arbiter for any final absolute truth. We, just as it was conditioned by what our parents fed us, we can retrain ourselves to enjoy other tastes and maybe develop a subtlety in our taste that we can even taste the truth. Yeah, I think so.
I'm gonna say, shut up.
Shut up. You can put this in the video.
Okay, I think this is good for now. You're elevating way too high now.
you can only bring me down for a bit.
I know. I was like, okay, she's going up.
Come back.
She's going up.